Okay, it is May the 12th, 1 o'clock, and this is the Planning Committee of the Council. And our first item on the agenda is the Family Care Center audit. And so those folks who are going to talk with us about this, I'd invite you to the table here. And actually, though, you don't have a microphone, so maybe if you can get the portable mic, Dr. Helm, off of the podium, that would be really good. We're being flexible. That's
yes,
what this is called, is flexibility. Council members, you have 12 pages plus an additional yellow sheet of information on the Family Care Center audit. And so I would like to just go ahead, Commissioner Helm, and ask you to go ahead and begin to tell us what is here, and then we'll have some discussion.
Thank you very much. It's been a year ago that the request for a financial audit of the Division of Family Services Health Clinic was made by then council member Dr. David Stevens, who happens to be here today to make sure we've done this correctly. And we decided from that point that because this was a health clinic, that we needed to make sure that we engaged a firm that had experience in auditing medical entities. And to that end, we put out an RFP, and we had several responses. And after following the LFUCG purchasing protocol, we selected Blue & Company out of Louisville, Kentucky, and asked them to perform the financial audit that had been requested by the council. Let me just give you a little historical background. If you will remember, in November of 07, there was an internal audit of the health clinic that was done. That was just a routine. I think the internal auditor annually selects several programs, departments, and divisions to audit, and in 07, the decision was made to audit the health clinic, and so that was done in November. Following that, or at about the same time, if you'll remember, Management Partners was visiting with us and really going through and scrutinizing every aspect of government. And so in February of 08, we received a pretty significant report for them as well, and there were four items related to the Division of Family Services in that report. Following the internal audit and the Management Partners report, we decided to secure the services of Medical Management Solutions to do what we call a practice assessment of the health clinic. Because if you will remember, Management Partners talked about the gem that the clinic is and was at that time, and just simply wondered if we had all of the infrastructure in place to really support the clinic at the level that perhaps it needed to be supported. So Medical Management Solutions came in and did a practice assessment for us. And it was following the release of that report that Dr. Stevens called for a financial audit. And we believe that was very appropriate because it gave us the fourth piece, if you will, to really looking very carefully at this particular important component of our government. And so what I'd like to do at this point, you've received the report from Blue & Company, and I would just simply ask Mr. Dale Skaggs of Blue & Company to walk you through the report. He's got a PowerPoint. You received the packet last week, and with the exception of the executive summary page, which did not print for some reason, hopefully you have received a yellow copy of that, so you will have that for your records. And so I'll turn this over to Dale Skaggs.
Does everyone have the yellow, all council members have the yellow sheet? We need one or two more up here. Welcome, Mr. Skaggs.
Thank you. PowerPoint up here.
Okay. While you're getting that, I also want to acknowledge Dr. Stevens, who is with us today.
Thank you. As Marlene said, you know, initially we were engaged by Family Care Center to go ahead and provide financial. Is that on?
I think your mic needs to be closer or.
Okay. Is that a little better?
There you go.
Okay.
Thank you.
As Marlene mentioned, we were initially engaged to perform a financial statement audit for the Family Care Center. And after some careful through the planning process and part of our consideration, we determined fairly early on that we would not be able to provide what we would call an unqualified or a clean financial statement audit opinion. And the reason for that, we outlined in a letter I think you all received dated January the 15th, 2009. But very simply, the trial balance, or in other words, the clinic's records that we received, were not kept in a complete order for just the clinic entity. There were expenses that were recorded in the clinic's fund, but there were also expenses that were kept at the county government level. So in other words, we didn't have all of our data together on the expense side. On the revenue side, as we tried to tie back some of the revenue numbers that we had were given, we weren't able to match those back to some of the internal clinic reports. And in addition to that, as we talked with management and other folks, there were some various internal controls that were really lacking. And so through discussions with management, we determined that it wouldn't be beneficial, because at the end of the day, we would have to issue what we would call an adverse or disclaim on our opinion. And so we talked about the cost benefit of really what would be the value of providing a financial statement audit if we weren't going to be able to give you guys an opinion. There's not a lot of value to it if you don't put a clean opinion on it. And so we talked about things that we could do perhaps to give some level of assurance, or at least to give a feel for what was going on from a financial perspective in the operations outside of doing a financial statement audit. And so that's where we determined not to do the financial statement audit, but actually provided what we called a revenue cycle assessment. And so I'll run through that. For our purposes, again, we were engaged to provide the revenue cycle analysis. We looked at the financial perspective of the operations for the clinic for a five-year period. And to do that, we sampled 40 random patient accounts from each of the 5 years. So we looked at 200 accounts in total. See if I can get us on the one more, please. One more. Okay.
Sorry, you're a little out of range over there.
Okay. Yeah, let me see. Can you move it forward? One more? One more? One more. Okay. I think we're all on the same page now. Again, but by background, I mean, we were then engaged to provide the revenue cycle assessment. Our purpose or the objective of the engagement was to give management an idea over the five-year period, how are we doing operationally related to the financial perspective of the clinic. And so we looked at the 200 patient accounts. We interviewed personnel, examined some of your different policies, procedures, the different forms that you were using in some of your internal reports. In front of you is kind of a summary of the areas that we looked at as well as our results. And just summary format, again, we looked at 9 different areas.
These are on the yellow sheet, because, okay. And probably at some point, council members will want a copy of the PowerPoint.
Sure. I'll just leave it with you.
Thank you.
So again, I mean, overall, we looked at 9 different areas. We found 3 of them to be satisfactory. And by that, we mean we found major elements that we would expect to find that were operating in a pretty good result. The other 6 areas, you know, we were missing different pieces that we would expect to see in a clinic operation if we were going to get optimal results. So I'll walk through each one of the areas. I'll talk a little bit about what the area is, some of the reasons or the findings that we had for why we may have not given it a satisfactory mark, and then maybe what our recommendations were. I'll move through these kind of quickly, but if we want to stop and talk about it, just let me know. The first area we looked at was the patient registration and prior authorization. Again, as you would expect, when you show up to the doctor's office, you would have them check your guarantor information, who's the responsible party for the payment. You would want to check that the address has been updated and also get a copy of the insurance card. Historically, this was done at the clinic, but it was done by just placing a check mark on a log. You know, and our recommendation would be that you would get a copy of the information and keep it in the patient's record. Demographic capture is very, very similar to the first one. Again, are we getting all the information that we need to be able to generate a bill and to get good payment? So is the address correct? Do we have the right copayment amount? Things like that. There were instances at the clinic where maybe the guardian had changed or the address had changed. We just didn't find the documentation. But again, for the most part, these things were being performed. The third area, charge capture, just like it sounds, again, it's important for all the services that we provide to each patient that we code them appropriately, that we enter them into the billing system in a timely manner. One of the things that we noticed was that we weren't doing daily reconciliation of our charges, so it was hard to tell if we had captured all the charge sheets from that day. There were also instances that we noticed where maybe we weren't using the correct codes. So again, you know, we would kind of recommend that we establish a policy where every day we're checking the total patients that we saw against the total charges, and that, you know, before we submit a claim or bill a claim, that we have a qualified coder review that. Medical records documentation, again, it's just like it sounds. In the chart, when we see a patient, we need to document what was happening that day and who provided those services. You know, although our assessment didn't necessarily look at the validity of the codes that were assigned, that wasn't the purpose of our engagement, we did find some instances where physician's handwriting wasn't legible, which it happens quite often. But we need to make sure that when we're done, we've documented all the services that we performed so that we can bill appropriately and that we know who actually provided the services. So, and that would be our recommendation, that we work with the service providers just to make sure that we understand exactly what needs to be in there and that we can identify who provided the service. Billing, as a provider or a clinic, it's our responsibility to get a clean claim filled out, a claim that's free of errors, get it done in a timely manner so that patients can pay their responsibility and we can get our payments back. Prior to 2008, for the period that we looked at, all the claims were done on a paper format. So this is a little bit of an older way of doing business. Whenever we do things on a paper format, it's hard to track our changes if we have a denial or something like that. So many times we would find instances where we were making changes on paper that weren't documented or we couldn't follow, and then we would send them in through the mail. Things may get lost. It's a complicated way of doing business. So we're making the recommendation that we would go to an electronic submission process where we can track all of our changes, we can get to things in a more timely manner. When we look at the rendering provider and the billing provider, this is a regulation change that was made and was effective back in May of 2007. So it didn't apply to the biggest part of our sample, but we wanted to mention to the group and just to make sure everyone was aware that the person who renders the services needs to be the same person's billing provider number that we use. And there were some instances that we found where those didn't match. So again, we would make the recommendation that we just provide some education on that and that we get those two numbers matched up. And then denials management. Again, denials management is a process of when we have a claim that's been rejected or a claim that's been denied, that we actually have a process in place so that we can follow up in a timely manner and monitor so that those claims get fixed and that we receive our payment. In this area, the biggest issue was that we just didn't see the documentation. So there were instances where claims were denied, but we didn't understand why. There were instances where claims had been rebilled 4 and 5 times. But again, without the documentation, you don't know why. It's hard to learn from our errors that we've made. And then there was also instances where we noted accounts had been written off to a zero balance. So in other words, there was no payment. We just wrote the charges off. But without the documentation, we couldn't determine why we were doing this. So kind of the whole theme is really getting back to, we need proper documentation. As we go through the process, we need to make sure everything's well documented and included in the record. Cash application and adjustments to the accounts receivable. I mean, this is an area like you would assume anywhere where when the checks come in or the cash comes in, we'd like to see more than one person handling those accounts. And what we had observed was we just had one person who would collect the checks, log them in, post the payments, and make the deposits. And so, again, what we're saying, it'd be nice to have some segregation of duty in that area. The posting of the receipts need to be done in a timely manner. We found some instances where it had taken as long as 30 days to get the payments posted. Again, this should be done in 24 hours. If you want to know where you're at on a day-to-day basis, you don't need to have a stack of payments that haven't been posted. You won't get an accurate number. So the other thing that we noticed, and this was just a practice, but when the clinic would have a service, they would enter the charge. It would sit on the books until the payment came in, and then we would adjust the full charge off, put a new charge in that was equal to the payment amount, and then post the payment. So at any given time, we can never determine, or you would never know, what the true accounts receivable is. And so we were making the comment or suggesting that, you know, you would record the total charge. At the time you record the charge, you make an adjustment or an allowance for the portion you don't expect to collect, which would leave a balance that you expect to receive or your payment. You'll have a good accounts receivable number whenever you need it. And then finally, refunds and credit balances. This issue really didn't come up in the 200 accounts that we looked at, but from time to time, you will receive maybe an overpayment, a patient paid a copay or too much, or the insurance had overpaid. And so what we wanted to bring to your attention was, because we didn't find a policy where it specifically talked about how we were going to approve returning these monies, what our threshold would be, those kind of things. So we just make the recommendation that we should establish a policy that deals with credit balances that would kind of be in line with what the state's regulations were. So to kind of summarize everything and to put it all in a nutshell, you know, we looked at the whole revenue cycle. We tested many areas. Like I said, three of the areas we looked at were satisfactory. The other six were kind of below industry standards. So to provide a conclusion or our report to you, you know, after careful review of the billing operations, inclusive of the period from July 2003 through June of 2008. That's right. Okay, we'll get there. After, again, well, we looked at all the operations. We looked at the period from July 2003 through June of 2008. And our conclusion was, after looking at all the evidence, that things were in a substandard order, or no, below industry standards, and that they were not producing optimal results that you'd expect to see. So that's kind of our report in a summary format, but I'd be happy to talk about any questions that you have.
Council members, if you have questions, please log in to your computer screen. Thank you very much for that, and we do have some council members who have questions. First is Councilmember Feigl.
Thank you, Chairwoman. Just a quick question. You talked about written billing and that you were recommending that this be done electronically. It sounded like a lot of things needs to be converted to an electronic record keeping. But my question is the equipment available at this point in time that you would need, or is this something that you need to build into your budget?
Well, one of the steps that we took early on was, effective July 1, we outsourced our billing to a medical billing company, and we send them the information, and then they do all of the billing for us. This is their expertise, and so they are, for the past year, we feel like we have been in good shape with regards to that. I think if we were to bring this back in-house, I think we'd have to have a lot of things, not only electronic, but again, if we move forward to have the University of Kentucky assume the operations, they have an entire building that this is pretty much all they do. And so, again, I think the clinic would be in really good shape and in good hands.
Okay. I'd forgotten about that. Thank you.
Councilmember Beard.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The cause of all of this, was it a staffing deficiency in numbers? Was it a deficiency in quality? What, or could you discern that from what you were
doing? From our information, I mean, we didn't really get into the root cause of why things were happening. Again, we analyzed 40 charts and kind of reported on the results, so we didn't really dig back into what. And again, you got to remember, we're going back to July of 2003 on some of these accounts. So we didn't really ask the question, what was the cause, but just this was where we were at on the accounts that we looked at.
Commissioner, do you have?
Again, since I was not here in 2003, I don't know what the staffing level was at that particular time. What I can tell you is that from 2007 forward, staffing was, I think, pretty steady there for a time. We began to have some turnover, but I think the individuals who had the responsibility for the billing, I believe those positions remained fairly consistent throughout that time period. And if you'll remember, the practice assessment actually said we were overstaffed for the amount of patients we were seeing, for the total dollar amount that we were capturing, that we were overstaffed in some areas. And that was when we decided to really take a greater look at, you know, do we have the infrastructure in place to really operate a clinic?
One further question, I guess, that with the outsourcing of the billing, was there a corresponding lowering of the size of staff?
Yes. We had a couple of individuals who chose to separate from the organization. And in some cases, those were, in several cases, those were the individuals that the practice assessment had indicated that we were probably overstaffed.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
You're welcome. We have one more council member who has a question, but she's not in the room right now. Is there any other question from council members? Yes, Councilmember Stennett.
Commissioner Helm, just in general on the Family Care Center, are we still in discussion, I mean, with UK to take it over 100%? That's going to happen?
Yes,
for sure.
With your approval, we are in negotiations with them to work out the details where they will assume operations. I think the good thing about that is this is a primary focus of the UK, you know, College of Medicine and the Medical Center. This is what they do. And they have a strong commitment for the clinic to remain because it's where they prepare a number of their residents. And they have reported to us that a number of their residents who go through doing their residency within the clinic do exceptionally well on their boards and other kinds of things. So they are very committed, and they understand that this clinic is truly a gem, is truly something very, very precious and special to the community. And they are committing very strongly to not only keeping it there, but also to making sure that dental is returned to the clinic. And so we're very excited about this.
What is the financial impact on that decision? Do we have any rough numbers?
We do not.
Well, I assume we'll save some money?
We will. And I think, you know, again, that's part of it. I'm not sure that we're going to be able to tell you exactly how much we're going to save, because I think, as Dale said, we never really understood the true cost of what operating the clinic was, because we were not capturing, you know, all of the costs. We were not capturing the cleaning cost and the overhead and the utilities and others. So this is a real challenge for us. We've had some individuals to go into the clinic and determine the square footage, and they're now trying to figure out what would be a fair cost for the university to compensate LFUCG for operating the clinic. But to give them history, we can't, because we've really never kept our records in that particular manner.
Yeah, you can't manage what you can't measure. But so we'll still own the land. They'll still be our property. We'll still do the maintenance, I assume. They'll run the actual care part.
That's correct. Yeah, okay. And we're, like I said, we're working out the details, and we intend to bring those back to the full council before mid-June, so that we can have a smooth transition July 1.
And if I'm not mistaken, 90% of the people we receive out there are on Medicaid claims?
It's about 92%, I think, Medicaid, and the rest private insurance and private pay or self-pay.
Very good. Mm-hmm. Thank you, ma'am.
And Commissioner Helm, just for the public, to be sure the public understands, Urban County Government will still run the Family Care Center. We just won't be running the clinic.
That's correct.
In
the building,
yes,
that is called the Family Care Center,
yes,
is the Division of Family Services. The Department of Social Services has three divisions, and Family Services will continue to be the primary resident of that particular facility, where we provide services to teen moms, where we have a preschool program, where we're doing a number of other programs focused on families and especially teen moms. And so, yes, we will continue to be in that particular facility, and we'll be partnering with the University of Kentucky, and we're looking forward to that.
Good. Thank you. Councilmember Lawless.
Thank you. Actually, you answered my question and made the point I think it's really important for the public to know that we're those the medical services that are currently being provided there will continue and even more, and hopefully higher quality and reach more people, and that we are still operating the Family Care Center, other programs. So that's all. Thank you.
Are there any other council members who have comments or questions? Dr. David Stevens has gone to the front of his chair to speak. Welcome, Dr. Stevens.
Thank you. It's good to be back, though this is a little unfamiliar position for me. But I'm pleased that the audit was done, and it, I think, reinforces some information that was already well known to the managers and to others. One of the things we hope to get from this audit was the total income of the family care clinic and its annual disbursements. It had been said that it was in the black through the years and was not costing the government anything to operate. But I gather, Mr. Skaggs, from your comments that you were unable to make that determination.
That's correct. I mean, we were never able to fully reconcile the revenues and the expenses to come up with what the net income or net loss would have been.
Do you have an estimate, or did you come have an idea?
We don't, but I can tell you through some of the discussions or some of the conversations. I mean, I thought it was understood that this was possibly a break-even type operation through the years, looking at just the what was recorded in the clinics fund. There's approximately another $300,000 to $400,000 of overhead or expenses that were paid for outside of just that clinic fund. So if it was break-even before, we're maybe $300,000 to $400,000 of a loss once we attribute the overhead and the other expenses that
were paid. And that was on an annual basis, you would estimate?
Yes.
Okay, well, that's important, and thank you. I have had conversations with Dean Jay Perman, and the UK views this as a community service for the College of Medicine, and they're looking forward to this arrangement to partner with the city and to provide that continuing service to the families and the children that need it there. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you very much. Is there anyone else who has further comment in the audience, or Dr. Helm?
Let me just make a couple of points. One, I was going to, again, thank Dr. Stevens for requesting the audit and for his ongoing support. I would remind you that Lisa Coleman, who did the practice assessment for us, which gave us the information really to take some of the next steps, is certainly here and willing to answer questions if there are any. Our outside billing company, our external billing company, about 3 weeks ago, sent us some information. We had asked them to go back and to begin to look at recovering perhaps some of the dollars that we were being told we are, you know, because of some of the practices that we, you know, you heard Dale talk about the fact that we were very behind in asking for reimbursement and getting our bills in. And what I had come to learn, or what we had come to learn, was that you have a year to go back and to seek redress from Medicaid. So in other words, if there were bills that we had submitted and they were not paid, or maybe they were denied, in some cases they were denied because we had left off maybe the child's Social Security number, or we had failed to indicate what tooth was pulled or filled. And, you know, Medicaid was saying, we want to pay you for this, but you've got to fix this bill and you've got to send it to us in good order. 3 weeks ago, our external billing company reported to us that they have recovered for us $171,000 that we left on the table in just 1 year. So if you think about the fact that we did not recover, or we were not able to bill in a timely manner for $171,000, and that was just for the 9 months that they looked at from July to March, and that was just for 2008-2009. Imagine if we would be allowed to go back for just the last 5 years, mm-hmm. not to mention perhaps even further. The other thing I want to remind everyone is that when the clinic was initially started, it was a wonderful concept to provide healthcare and education and childcare for young moms and families. It's a wonderful concept. The very first year that the health care was provided, we had 135 patient visits. Last year, we had over 12,000. So the clinic is truly something very special, and I think UK is very fortunate that we're willing to partner with them. I think they are very excited about the fact that they're going to have the opportunity to assume a clinic that has worked so hard to build its patient accounts and to provide service, which is considered to be excellent. I think the bottom line is that LFUCG had a wonderful idea. We've incubated it for 18 years, and I think it's very appropriate that we now turn it over to an entity in which operating health facilities is their mainstay.
Good information you just gave us. Just out of curiosity, did that money go into the general fund, or where did that money go? That $171,000.
Yes, it will come
will
into
it go into the general.
It will come into the clinic, and then we okay. certainly can, you know, if it's money that's left over, if we don't need. But you also heard Dale
right.
say that we are actually expending more than what we were taking in,
right.
And so that money will not be turned over to the University of Kentucky. At the end of June, we will then balance the books, and then anything left in the clinic that is not needed for our operation of the clinic through June 30th, we would assume would just automatically revert back to the general
okay.
fund.
Thank you. And Councilmember Blues has a comment or question.
Just one question. Will the same outside billing agency remain, or will UK take that over as well?
UK will take that over as well. They have their own billing company, and that company will assume the responsibility for billing for the university.
And collect,
yeah.
Thank you.
Now, Dr. Helm, does as this goes forward with UK, would we expect to see an annual report, or what would be your vision in terms of an accountability given the history here and something that would come to council?
The two attorneys are actually working out some of the details,
okay.
but one of the issues that I have certainly raised with our council is that I think since we are going to be putting on the table an amount that the university would compensate LFUCG for annually, in order for us to go forward after that first year, we need to have a report. So we need to know how well are they doing? Mm-hmm. Are there some things that we need to step up and do in order to enhance and make the clinic more accessible? Did we run into any challenges this first year? So hopefully we will come forward to you with a plan that says at the end of the first year we will take a step back and look at those things that need to be changed, deleted, added, whatever, and that it would include the university giving us a report on the success and the numbers from year one, because we believe the clinic has the ability, and I think Lisa Coleman from Medical Management Solutions has told us that the clinic has the potential to bring in perhaps even three times as much revenue as it is currently bringing in. And I think the university will have a vested interest in making sure that it is reaching its maximum potential. And they'll have the expertise right there. We're having to bring in a lot of people because we just simply do not have it within house. And again, no one has done anything intentionally wrong. I just think we did not and do not have the infrastructure that I think is really needed in order to run a healthcare entity.
Mm-hmm. Do you need any action from this committee?
I think it would be great if you would accept the report and, you know, put that into record, because I think it is important. It certainly has taken a lot of hours and a lot of time, and I think it needs to be accepted
okay.
into the record.
Well, there don't seem to be any more questions. Would anyone care to make a motion to accept this into the record? Councilmember Blues?
Second.
Councilmember Beard moved, and Councilmember Blues seconded that we accept this into the record, and of course, that motion, if passed, would go on to the full council. So is there any further discussion? All those in favor, say aye. Any opposed? Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. Thank you also, Mr. Skaggs. And the next item on our agenda is the Newtown Pike Design Ordinance. This is coming back to us for a second time. And Chris King, our director of the Division of Planning, promised you would bring it back when it was a little more filled out. And so I'd like to go ahead and turn this over to you. This is pages 13 to 18 in the packet.
Thank you, Ms. Gordon. We will spare you repeating the thorough presentation we gave to you back at the end of January, but it would probably be good for me just to reframe why we are here, what this ordinance is intended to do, and what we've done since we were last here that give us comfort that we are ready to proceed forward with this particular piece of legislation. As we have been working on the Newtown Pike Extension project for many years, as we know now, one of the things that has been of great interest is the redevelopment that such a major new urban highway would likely spur. As you know, concerns about that manifested itself in so many ways, from the need to rebuild the South End neighborhood, which is underway as a major concern, and also a concern about what type of commercial redevelopment will happen along that corridor. And very early on in the road planning process, a small area plan corridor study was done that made a number of recommendations and gave a vision for an urban corridor to go with that urban highway. As we got a little further into the project, we realized that in order to affect that and to have some tools to help us address those kinds of concerns, we were going to need a study that would help us identify what that character would be and to make recommendations as to primarily standards that could be applied as opposed to guidelines, although there are some guidelines. And a study was done a couple of years ago called the Newtown Pike Extension Commercial Design and Property Access Standards. We married that with the need to control access, physical access, driveways to that project. So those two were worked together. We had the engineering firm of ACE, if I recall, at that time was their name, who did the engineering aspect and the access part of that. And we had CMW do the design part. And we had numerous meetings down at the Carver Center, involved the property owners that would be involved, and completed a study as part of the project. In the interim, then we had more delays than anticipated in getting to the record of decision. And although we did a lot of good work and we had a lot of public interaction at the time of the study, we felt once the record of decision came would be the time to come forth with an ordinance to try to implement this. So back last fall, we sent a draft to you of that ordinance and both talked to you again. I think it was January before we actually were able to get before you as of your crowded docket. But when we came to you in January with a draft ordinance, we felt given there had been a fairly lengthy bit of time from the time the study was done to now when we're actually proposing the ordinance, it would be wise and smart, prudent to re-engage the property owners in the corridors, bring them up to date, and get any feedback. So that's where we left it with you in January after we gave you an overview of the principles and how this ordinance would work. So in the interim, we went back out and re-identified the current property owners in the corridor that would be affected by the provisions of this ordinance, basically all those properties that will be abutting the Newtown Pike Extension. We sent them a letter advising them that this process was going on, and we invited them to a public meeting, which was held at the Carver Center on the evening of April 7th. We sent out over 100 letters, and we had a turnout of approximately 20 to 25 individuals, as I recall, at which time we discussed the ordinance, the proposed ordinance. We got feedback and generally had no significant concerns or issues raised by those property owners that attended. We were also contacted by a property owner or two who had become aware of the ordinance and met with us one-on-one to look at how that ordinance might affect the ideas they had for the future of their properties. So at this point, we then did some tweaking. I know Andrew Grunwald, who is here, because of some changes in the access provisions, needed to make a few tweaks. We did a little cleanup in the language and the map. We have sent those to you. They are in your packet today. And I'm ready to answer questions, talk longer, explain anything that you might be concerned about regarding this ordinance, and then see where you want to go from here.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to be sure, you did say that when you met with property owners, there were no concerns, or were there no significant concerns?
No significant concerns. Gosh, most of the people at the neighborhood meeting were, when's the construction going to start?
Right.
I think, again, like all the community, a lot of interest in that aspect of the project. But we have, proposed, we think, a fairly reasonable set of standards. There's some flexibility. Basically, that regardless of what your zoning is currently in the corridor, if you abut the road, you would have to submit a development plan that the Planning Commission would review. The Planning Commission would be charged to use the study in helping to put the requirements on the design characteristics of the ordinance. It's not so much architecture per se, it's arrangements of building, creating an urban feel, having taller buildings, have them address the street, having parking behind the buildings, stepping back away on taller buildings near the street, and basically the Planning Commission being that tool. We modeled this after your Richmond Road ordinance, which goes back to the 80s. And so basically, in the end, any variances or waivers of this, which we don't expect there would be many, would actually come back to the council ultimately. But in each case, the Planning Commission would review it and make a recommendation to you. And that's the process model we used.
Okay. Very good. Thank you. Are there any questions from council members? No questions. I think that's a good thing.
Good.
Well, Chris, I thank you very much. Now, do you need some action from us in order to move this forward?
Right. The next step would be, if this committee so recommended to the full council, then the full council would put it on as a matter to consider.
Okay.
Again, we will be available if any late arrivals as to concerns or questions about this ordinance appear. This is not a panic piece of legislation. We certainly want to get it in place before we get a lot of physical activity in the corridor. But again, we are ready to engage anyone that comes with any concerns as this moves forward.
Okay,
but I think
it is
time to move it on, would
okay.
be our recommendation.
Do I hear a motion? Councilmember Blues moved to recommend this to the full council. Do I hear a second? And Councilmember Feigl seconds. Is there any more discussion or any discussion? No? If not, those in favor, please say aye. Any opposed? All right. Thank you so much. I just have one comment. It's good to see a plan such as this come forward before the fact and before the extension gets built, so that we've really thoroughly vetted it. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
This will go forward as a full as a motion to the council.
Excellent.
Thanks, Chris.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Council members, we have written reports. And is Andrew still here? Oh, there you are. Would you like to? I know there's a very brief page 19, and all we need is brief, Andrew. Newtown Pike status. And if you want to mention any particular highlights. That's on page 19 of the packet. Welcome.
Thank you very much. I'll just go over this very quickly. Essentially, this concentrates on Phase 4 and Phase 1 of the Newtown Pike Extension project. Currently, Phase 4, the right-of-way, there are 20 parcels. All of the relocation offers have been made, all of the acquisition offers have been made, and all parcels have been submitted for eminent domain. It's essentially the right of entry. Now, all this work is being done by the Transportation Cabinet for our behalf and their behalf. Of those 20 parcels, two have been closed, which is essentially the Transportation Cabinet now has them, owns them outright. And two additional parcels are pending before the Urban County Council. One was one that we, the City of Lexington, owned. We are donating it to the Transportation Cabinet for the road. The other one is a portion of the Lower Rupp Arena parking lot. I think that's the Lexington Center Corporation. The remaining parcels, the Transportation Cabinet has not stopped negotiating, even though they are pending legal action. They are still trying to reach a settlement even before you have to actually have the eminent domain effective. And most of those parcels are getting close to actually finalizing the offer and everything for the transfer. Utilities is ongoing. The Transportation Cabinet has also graciously, they're going to oversee the utilities. We are going to put them into the construction contract, so they're going to operate at the same time. The primary utility that we were concerned with early on was a Kentucky Utility Transmission line that runs down Manchester. It is a very large distribution line. The good news is we are not going to have to move or relocate that line. Some of the utilities that are connected to that line will have to be relocated, but this is a very good thing for our project. With that said, we have discovered a 16-inch water line which lies underneath our primary bridge center pier. According to the Kentucky American Water Company, they will not be able to relocate this line until after November 2009. We are going to try to work with them to see if we can expedite that. Otherwise, the Transportation Cabinet is going to try to work around it. For construction, the plans themselves are in a final stage. We have had them reviewed by the Transportation Cabinet. The Transportation Cabinet has graciously offered to oversee the construction. And they have thrown a good portion of their internal staff to working on this. They have set a July letting date, July 24th. That is the anticipated date to let this project. We're still hopeful. That pretty much concludes the Phase 4 update.
And Andrew, just yes, in case anyone's watching, Phase 4 is Main Street to Versailles Road. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am. Main Street to Versailles. It includes the bridge over Overtown Branch. The Phase 1 area of the project is along Durruti Street, basically from the Versailles Road Viaduct back up to McKinley Street and the lower Davis Bottoms. We did do some advanced acquisition of two parcels. That was Bryant Renall, and it's called the Hodge property. Those two parcels have been purchased by the Transportation Cabinet, and they are now in the control of the project. For the remainder of that mitigation area, there are 55 total parcels. Of those 55, we have advanced purchased 13. We have five offers, which are pending. And the remaining right-of-way will be purchased utilizing a consultant, which we have advertised, we have negotiated with, and we have an engineering agreement. We just got back this week, as a matter of fact, and it will be in front of the council before you all go on summer break for ratification to purchase the rest of the property in Phase One. That was pretty brief. If there are any questions, I can
Are there any questions?
Yes, sir.
Please log in if you have a question. Councilmember Blues.
Thank you, Andrew. Getting back to the eminent domain for right of entry, how does that work? And what is it that we initiate the process, and so even before a property is purchased, we can begin to move utilities there? Is that it?
Yes, sir. We, in consultation with the Transportation Cabinet, what we did was is we had all of the property appraised. We also had the offers made to the individuals. While the offers were being made, we explained to them that we were going to impose the right right of entry. If a settlement could not be reached upon, you know, in a timely manner. That process, right off the bat, from the point at which you file it, takes a minimum of 60 days just to go through the court system. So we explained to each individual that we had to file the paperwork now, but this did not exclude negotiation in between the individual and the Transportation Cabinet, who is actually buying it. For instance, if the Transportation Cabinet, we presented an offer to you, the papers were filed, if the property then closes and we have a transaction, that would be dropped. Does that kind of make sense? Okay.
And I have a second question. Can you give us an update, a timeline on Phase One for
the mitigation area?
Yes.
We are going to be in the process of buying right away for the remainder of this year. We will have final construction plans by the end of this year. We anticipate of having houses under construction and be to the point of moving in approximately 4 years.
So we're moving forward with purchases or this year?
Correct.
But it's going to take 4 years to move in time. And are there some problems with moving forward faster rather than slower?
Well, it is our hope to do it faster, but when we sat down and we did our best to lay it all out, to find out how the contracts would work out, the construction of the houses, the demolition of the existing houses, the fill of the site. And that was our best estimate. Now, that doesn't mean it has to take 4 years, but as things look at, as we look forward from this point, that's where we anticipate.
I think you thought earlier it might be sooner than 2013 or so.
I do agree. It would be nicer to do it sooner, but I would hate to commit to a date at which I couldn't 100% guarantee. Some of that also depends upon funding. When the funding will become available for the actual construction of houses. There are a lot of unknowns in that equation. As we work a little bit more towards the end of this year, we might be able to refine that date a little bit better.
Yep. I think it would be helpful for us to be able to keep in touch on where we are and whatever issues or problems might be might be holding things up. I know this is a complicated and difficult, many-faceted process, but I'd hope that that phase one would be more in sync with phase four, and it looks like phase four is going to outdistance the neighborhood rebuilding.
Yes, sir. Phase four will probably be completed before the mitigation area in the neighborhood. The most important thing is that we do have at least we have the funding to buy the right of way, and we are proceeding with that as quickly as we can.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Vice Mayor Gray.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Andrew, I was curious about the resolution on the intersection at Manchester and Newtown, and the the property owners and a number of people in that area had inquired about the elevation of the entry Newtown into Manchester and the streetscape presence there. How was that resolved?
We are going to take our streetscape plan, or whatever we put back as a streetscape, will mirror whatever the downtown master plan is. For instance, we will utilize the same streetlights, the same if benches are to be set.
I think the concern was excuse me for interrupting, but not so. The issues, as I recall them, are the significant issues related to the elevation, the entrance from Newtown into Manchester, and its relationship to those contiguous properties, those properties right beside it, so that they would be accessible. Those properties would be accessible to pedestrians and create a pedestrian-friendly, welcoming urban intersection. And that was what Distillery District was interested in. That's what Cleve Pohl, I believe, Cleve was involved in it. And so I believe you all met with them, and how did that resolve? I hadn't heard, so I was curious.
I think I know the parcel. As you're coming in, you're talking about the parcel at the corner of Newtown.
Right.
What will we make?
Newtown, Manchester, right?
Yes, sir.
Right.
We met with the stakeholders when we were working on the bridge design. We did include into our design a staircase that would go down to the bike trail that will be placed underneath the bridge. At that same time, we also we negotiated with the property owners. I believe it was 855 Manchester. Is that lot? When we acquire their property, we are going to acquire just the right of way we need, basically to the back of the sidewalk and maybe a few feet more. The embankment that we are going to construct there will be it will utilize what we call a slope protection easement, which still allows them to have control of the property. Essentially, they can still place a building on it. They can place it all the way back up to the back of the curb. And as long as they do not destabilize the bank, they will be able to make those improvements to that site.
Okay. As a summary, would it be fair to say that there was a consensus and acceptance of the direction on this? Okay, great.
Yes, sir.
What about the bridge design itself? How is that resolved?
We met with a series of what we call stakeholders. Mm-hmm. We gathered input from all of them. We had a series of meetings, very interesting meetings. And we had the engineers on one side and the planners on one, and We went back and forth, but we all reached a consensus, and the current design of that structure was accepted by everybody, including the
architects.
The architects.
Poles, I believe.
Yes, sir. They were involved.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact,
that's great.
A lot of their design efforts actually went into shaping what it looks like. We also have consensus from the Lexington Center Corporation. So it was a very good process. Everybody did agree. So
good to hear that.
Yes,
it's a good illustration of how people who first appear to be dissenters, contrarian about something, actually you can come to the table and you all emerged with an inspired project. I think it'd be useful for the council to see that maybe in a rendered version and the public to see that as soon as we can.
Yes, sir.
It's going to represent a major entrance to the city and affect us for a long time.
I think we can provide that.
Can we get
sir.
That then?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. When do you think we can, any idea on that? Maybe you can talk to the engineers and see. If you don't have a rendering of it, maybe you can ask them about getting one.
Yes, sir. I can probably get it pretty soon. So.
Thank you. Thanks, Chair.
Councilmember Blues.
All right. Thank you. If I could just follow up on your question, Vice Mayor, and your comments, Andrew, we did have a series of meetings with engineers and planners, and I think we had Lexington Center represented as well. David Lord was there. Town Branch Trail, Van Meter Pettit was there. You know, I try to confuse the issue a few times by asking dumb questions throughout this process, and it was really fascinating to see the engineers and the architects and the designers and those who really wanted to see a bridge that looked like a bridge, looked like an entry. And was at the same time functional, provided access to and from the trail, and also provided for future artistic expression. The bridge as it's designed will provide pedestals for statuary as funding for such public art projects becomes available. So I was really I was really fascinated by, as you say, how various entities could come together. Members of the community with various professional and artistic perspectives, the state and the city could really work together and bring this project to to consensus. So I think you'll be pleased by the rendering.
Consensus that
see.
Produced imagination and inspiration.
Well, there was all of that, yes.
Right.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Are there other questions? Thank you very much, Andrew. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Council members, you have a written report of the Liberty Todd's Phase 1B project. And although it's written, I know we have Bob Baird in the audience if you have any questions. Councilmember Stennett's always ready for you, Mr. Baird. This wasn't really meant to be a presentation, but you don't mind a few questions, do you?
No.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Chair.
Stennett.
Just for the people watching at home, we completed Liberty Road last year, Phase 1A, which was a connection to Hamburg through Starshoot Parkway. We actually cut Phase 1 off to be 1B there at the intersection of Man of War and Todd's and Liberty Roads. And we get a lot of calls, Bob, asking about the progress of why we cut it off right there, et cetera. Don't want to go into that. I just want people to know what our timeline is to getting that intersection fixed, because it's one of the biggest traffic nightmares we have in this city right now, with four lanes going into two, and then one of the busiest top 10 intersections in Fayette County. And the sooner the better. I know it was supposed to be let in March, then we said June, and now I think the Transportation Cabinet on the state level has changed it once again. So can you give the people watching a brief update about where we're at on timeline on getting this project done?
The bottom line on the bidding is it is set for a September 25th letting date through the Transportation Cabinet. Where we are right now is, as with the Newtown Pike project on the right-of-way acquisitions, the eminent domain right of entry process will be used so that right-of-way acquisition is not a hang-up in getting us to the bid on time in September. Currently where we are is in the utility relocation phase. The first company out of the gate, I guess, was Columbia Gas. They are nearly wrapped up in their work. The one who is on the longest timeline because of the delivery of materials is Kentucky American. And the timeline they project is actually the one that is determining the letting date in September. So that's about.
So we have three right-of-ways left. We're going to proceed by condemnation and then the utility relocation. So, and I assume you all are having the monthly meetings about with the utilities, make sure they're on target.
We are. We have bi-monthly meetings where we review this project and all of our projects. We had a meeting on May 1st with the Highway Department to talk specifically about maintenance of traffic issues out in the middle of Man of War in that intersection while we're doing this construction. The state has a set of the plans. They're looking at them closely since they'll be doing construction oversight on this. We're trying to take steps now, do the homework that we can and need to do now to make the disruption as minimal as possible.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Chair.
You're welcome. Are there other questions? I appreciate your being here. Thanks, Bob. Council members, the only other item is if you'll turn to page 20, there are a few items in committee that we have dealt with and passed on to the full council. So I would like to request motions to take them off of our outstanding issues. And the first one is the electrical inspector fee schedule. Is there any reason to keep that on? Motion to remove and a second. All those in favor say aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, so that will be removed. The next one I'm aware of is the Destination 2040, unless we did move forward the endorsement of the value statements. Do we want to keep that in committee or move that out of committee? What's your sense, Councilmember James?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would actually like to see if we can keep this in committee and figure out what we're going to do with that value statement.
That sounds fine.
Thank you.
I know we had a lot of pieces of that weren't really attended to, but we felt comfortable just with that one motion, so we'll keep that in. Next, on the page 21, we did have a motion going forward to approve in concept the Heisel Property Master Plan, so I'm thinking we could remove that if I hear a motion.
Motion to remove.
Okay, Councilmember Stennett moved and Councilmember Blues seconded to remove Heisel Property Master Plan. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. And are there others? I would like to put in a plug for the Parks Master Plan. I have two volunteers who volunteered to serve on that ad hoc to look at funding recommendations and would certainly encourage any of the rest of you. Councilmember Feigl and Councilmember James are going to serve on that. And Councilmember McCord. Very good. Is there anyone else? Councilmember Blues, you had your hand up, but you quickly withdrew.
That was for something else, Madam Chair.
Okay. Now, are there other issues on here that you feel can be removed? Okay, Councilmember Blues.
I'm sorry, this isn't to be removed. I have a question about where we might be with the downtown master plan. Seems to me that's something that we want to be moving forward. And
would you like to see that on the next planning committee?
Yes, I would.
All right. I'll ask Paul to go ahead and put that on the next planning committee.
Thank you.
Councilmember Lawless.
On the downtown master plan, they are working, infill and redevelopment is working on form-based guidelines to put with that. So there are several recommendations. So could we put that off another, what do you think?
Do we need the specifics of the 16 recommendations before we look at it in concept? You want everything fleshed out in detail? We could move them. We could, of those 16 recommendations, we could look at them one at a time, if that would be better. If we're going to do detail of each one, I think it'll take us a few months.
I agree.
I think so, too.
What's your sense?
Dr. Blue.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Vice Mayor?
Well, I was actually inclined to listen to other thoughts on this. The timing, you know, it having been developed, the plan having been developed now almost 5 years ago, there seems to be a expectation of the council that the council will endorse it. And if we don't, there seems to be a convenient excuse that whatever happens that's not consistent with the master plan is our responsibility or neglect, which I suspect is arguably not the case, but we probably need to take it up. And I don't know if waiting on form, I mean, the form-based model is a long process, and it was one of the recommendations.
Right.
So I'm not.
So I think one of the reasons we've been waiting is to hear from infill and redevelopment. If we don't need to wait on that group,
then that's fine, and I'll try to figure out between now and next month.
Councilmember James.
I never thought that we were waiting as far as the downtown master plan relating to infill and redevelopment. I serve on the infill and redevelopment steering committee, and I don't, and if someone else on that committee can tell me if it's different, but you know, the downtown master plan was way before this current infill and redevelopment steering committee has been working.
So your sense is they're not going to make any recommendation that would hold it up? Well, let's look at it next month.
Okay.
Then. And we don't, is it your sense we don't really need too much detail on those 16 recommendations? Councilmember Blues?
Well, I agree with that, and I think that we want to bring it forward and try to get it set so we can bring it to the full council for adoption.
Other thoughts? Councilmember Beard.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You know, there are going to be, of those recommendations, there'll be some that'll be pretty easy. And you had indicated maybe that we would look at them separately, each one of those points.
Oh,
separately.
I don't. It's up to this committee.
Yes.
I don't really.
Well, I'm suggesting that we do that so that we can go ahead and lay some to rest. And then if we've got to wrestle over two or three of them, we can do that without having these others hanging over our head.
Okay. Other questions or comments? We'll get it on, if it suits the committee, we'll get it on the docket for the June agenda. Okay. Other issues on the list of outstanding issues?
Madam Chair?
Yes. Councilmember Lawless.
The Blue Horse thing that we voted on last time didn't, what Councilmember Blues had to report to council didn't reflect what the motion and that was passed. The wording was off. Do you have that with you? Lordy, Lordy. So does anybody have that motion available? I'm sorry.
Not right.
I've been running from meeting to meeting.
Well, I know one of the issues about that was we had about 20 minutes left, and we didn't have time for public comment, and it was sort of a rushed discussion. If you would like to have it next month for a second.
I made a motion and it passed, mm-hmm. but what was recorded was not the motion I made. That's the issue.
Okay. So
it left out the Wayfinder signs.
Okay. Councilmember Blues.
Just a clarification, we did not make a motion. At least when I brought it to we made a motion and passed it in planning committee.
Yes.
I did not bring that forward to the full council because the minutes were at odds with the motion that Councilmember Lawless had made. So that's where we are.
That's what I was trying to say.
This moment.
So the issue is we need to take a look at the minutes. Is that the issue?
Yes, we need
maybe to. Maybe make some corrections to the minutes.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Other comments about the blue horse? Okay. Perhaps it was the special planning committee meeting, yes. We did have to, well, actually, it was not the special planning committee meeting. It was the 1 o'clock regular planning committee meeting because we took up the two parks issues in the special meeting. So maybe, Vicki, maybe you could, well, I think what we need to do maybe is review the tape. Paul has volunteered to do that with you. And bring back a recommendation for the minutes. Does that sound workable? Does that suit you, council member? Yes. So if the two of you will review the minutes if you could bring, maybe you can email me a recommendation for. Councilmember Blues did the report out, and the motion was not brought forward because there was a question.
Okay, cool.
So, and then we'll take a look at that as committee members and make the change if it's necessary. Other issues on the list that you would like to attend to? No? Very good. All those in favor of adjourning, say aye. Thank you very much for being here. Okay. Paul.
Lonely, I'm Mr. Lonely. I have nobody for my own. I'm so lonely. I'm Mr. Lonely. Wish I had someone to call on the phone. Now I'm a soldier, a lonely soldier, away from home, through no wish of my own. That's why I'm lonely. I'm Mr. Lonely. I wish that I could go back home. Letters, never a letter. I get no letters in the mail. I've been forgotten. Oh, how I wonder, how is it I fail? Now I'm a soldier, a lonely soldier, away from home, through no wish of my own. That's why I'm lonely. I'm Mr. Lonely. I wish that I could go back home.
It was no accident, me finding you. Someone had a hand in long before we ever knew. Now I just can't believe you're in my life. Heaven's smiling.